What's happening tonight? Saw a couple questions already. That's the song that our business is named after, Ripple. Yeah, I saw somebody ask that. So tonight we're going to talk Steelhead. Eric, you better wake up. It's Steelhead time, buddy. Let me get this straightened out a little bit. Hopefully we don't have any connection issues tonight. I know last night we had some problems with, especially it seemed like folks in Cincinnati were using a lot of internet last night. It seemed like everybody in Cincinnati had a problem last night. What's up, Tyler? Thanks for coming tonight, man. So tonight we're talking Steelhead. If you're not awake, it's time to wake up because it's Steelhead time. It's time to talk about Chrome. So I debated on what fly to tie tonight, and I chose what is called a hex sparrow. And a hex sparrow is a really productive spring steelhead fly for us. But it can be productive any time of the year. The reason I chose that is I have a feeling there are quite a few beginner fly tiers on here tonight that are looking for kind of, you know, patterns to tie. And the hex sparrow, which we're going to tie tonight, and the sparrow, which we tied last night, they're very similar and use a lot of the same materials. And so I thought that'd be, it'd be a good one to tie, kind of buddy up and piggyback on last night. Plus, it's a great fly. It's, you know, hey, Eric, how are you, buddy? it's literally, you know, one of the top three flies I use every spring. Definitely top five. In some years, number one. This spring, it was fishing really well for us. What's up, Preston? Hopefully Declan's on there. So let's get started. Hex Sparrow, 9671 Mustad. So it's a, I'm sorry, 9672 Mustad. So 4X long streamer hook, 9672, size 6. We're back with the uni thread. This is yellow. So uni thread, 6-aught yellow. We're going to start it back at the bin so we don't waste a lot of thread. And if you have any questions, if you don't see something, if I'm doing something a little too quickly, just let me know. We'll get it figured out. Hey, Gene, how are you, man? Gosh, there's another blue Hungarian. You guys are going to kill me with this blue Hungarian fly. We have to get Ron Snyder to do a guest appearance one of these nights. So, all right, the tail. Grizzly, it'll be in reverse because it's the front camera, but Grizzly Marabou. So, hey, buddy. Hi, Nick. So this is not mini marabou. It's grizzly marabou. However, it is mini. Don't ask me why it's marketed that way or labeled that way, but that's the way it. If you order mini marabou, it won't be the same stuff. So get marabou that is grizzly marabou. This is tan. So we tie that in. This is a tail. We like a long tail on this thing. So it doesn't have to be shank length, but you know, fairly long tail. Wrap that sucker all the way to about 3/4, about right there, about 3/4 of the shank. Looks like the YouTube's working all right. Somebody comment, if you don't mind, on YouTube, just so I know the comments are working okay. Last night, it sounded like the video worked all right on YouTube, but it didn't, didn't work. As far as the comments went. So how are you, Stan? All right. So here we go. We got the tail. It's easy. Now we're going to take Spirit River, which is now owned by Hairline. Spirit River, squirrel blend dubbing in the color sulfur. So that's what the body's going to be. And this is a heavily dubbed fly. You'll see me again. Go back to licking my fingers, which I know I shouldn't be doing lately. Although I know I've cleaned them a lot today. Cleaned them all day. I power washed the house. I cleaned them all day. I have done things to my house I haven't done in the 18 years we live here. I literally climbed the roof today and power washed up in the second story and power washed the gutters. I don't know why I did that, but I felt like I had the time. So let's get it done. So this fly takes a lot of dubbing. I've played around with the idea. I've tried it over the years of putting an underbody to make it a little more bulk, a little less dubbing. To be honest with you, I don't think it takes that much dubbing to warrant that, but I have played around with it. So here we go. Hey, Garrett, I'm going to answer a bunch of your questions tonight, buddy. I got your email, and we were already going to go over a ton of that, so I figured I would just wait and answer them tonight for you. So we're going to go up that fly once, and we're going to go back it a second time, and we are going to add more dubbing. Like I said, this fly eats the dubbing, but this squirrel blend dubbing is really easy to work with. It dubs real well. It's nice and long, so it's a dubbing that when you are using a lot of dubbing like we are on this fly, it's pretty easy to apply and get on there in good bulk. We're going to bring it back up. Add a little bulk up there. All right. So we're about 3/4 of the way up the shank. And at that point, we are going to take back to the same thing we were with last night is the ringneck pheasant rump color natural. Now, last night on that small sparrow, which is laying right here, you can kind of see the difference in size. Okay, on the small one, we worked way down in here on the pheasant. Today, we've got a pretty large fly, so we're working about halfway up in this area. We've already grabbed a couple of feathers. Now, we're going to do something a little different as well with this one. We're still going to pull it back to where we get a couple wraps of the quote-unquote good feather. We're going to tie that in at that point, but not only are we going to tie one, I Find that spot. We are going to tie two of these feathers in. Snip that off. Like Eric said last night, it was a good point. These quote-unquote good feathers, which I don't use a whole lot of, you could varnish those and put some flex seal on them and use them for hopper wings. All right. Stroke that back. We're going to do two turns, and we are tying off. So we've got two feathers. We do two turns. We tie off. We snip. All right. Now we take our black mono eyes. So these are from Hairline. Black mono nymph eyes, size medium. And we're going to crisscross wrap those on there until they're nice and secure. We're going to work back behind the eyes with the thread. So we're back behind the eyes. And we're going to go right back to our dubbing. Like I said, this thing takes a lot of dubbing. But it is a phenomenal fly. It's not only a really good fly. I forgot to mention that. It's not only a really good fly for steelhead, but it's a great fly for salmon, kings in the fall. It's a very productive fly for us for salmon. It's one of my secret weapons. So I debated not tying it. I'm pretty secretive about some of my patterns, but this one is just such a great pattern, and I thought it would piggyback well from last night. So we're going to do some figure eight wraps around the eyes. We're going to build up a head. We're going to make one more wrap in front of the eyes, and we are going to whip finish. Like I said last night, and I think every video I've ever done, I don't use any head cement. That's all she wrote. The Hex Sparrow. It is a great fly. Again, I know I've said it, and I know there's some new people on here tonight, so I'm going to repeat it. I think a perfect fly has five characteristics. Number one, obviously, it catches fish. Number two, I want it to be easy to tie. I want it to be quick to tie. I want it to be cheap to tie. And I want the thing to be durable. These Hex Sparrows have all five of those characteristics. They are the perfect fly. And like I said, year in, year out, that is one of my top spring steelhead flies that I use. And it's also a really nice fall salmon fly. So, I thought it'd piggyback well last night with the more traditional, smaller sparrow, which is here. A lot different in size, pretty much the same pattern. So, yes, Eric, I did find my razor. And I cut myself for the first time since I was like 16. And when I did it, I was cussing you because you made me shave. It was your fault. Stinking sparrow. It's the week of the sparrow, apparently. So, yes, I found my razor, buddy. All right. Let me get these videos over, and we'll get going on the slideshow part. I put together hopefully a cool little breakdown of year-round steelheading. So let me get over there. I'll get these cameras moved, and we'll get going. All right, should be good. All right. Let me repeat again. If you have any questions, just put them down in the chat. I'm looking at the chat on those immediately. I'll sneak around every once in a while and check out the chat on YouTube as well, but I can't see that one. But I'll look. So if you have a question on YouTube, don't be afraid. All right. Yeah, Kevin, it's crazy how much snow we're supposed to get tonight. Average size of the steelhead, I would say 6 to 8 pounds. But as you'll see in this video or in this show, you're going to see a lot bigger fish too. I'd say average fish is probably about 6 to 8 pounds, somewhere in there. All right, let's roll. So year-round steelheading. I forgot last night, and I'll probably start every program with something that I forgot from the night before. We talked about fighting big fish last night, and this is something I forgot to mention. We talked about rod angles. We talked about not trying to keep fish out of wood. Let them do what they want to do. You're not going to keep them out of the wood anyway. Something I didn't mention last night, and that is keeping a rod low to keep the head, their head up on the surface of the river. So when their head comes up, that's when they're going to shake like crazy, and that's when we're going to lose a lot of fish. So if you notice here, when that head comes up, she brings the rod down. She did do what she's supposed to do there. So get that rod tip. It's screaming a lot of line off. We want to keep that belly, and the less line we have on the water, the line is creating, and therefore the less tension that we're going to have. So it's a lot better when they're running. The fish is really running is if we're going to put the other than that, get that rod down low. All right, couple just quick history of myself, and I haven't really talked about this. My earliest memories are fishing. I mean, I grew up on the river. This was me. Got in trouble because I went fishing before my without him. Luckily, he gave me a pop sucker and took a picture before I threw the fish. That's me. That's all I've done since I was a kid is fish. It's the latest MRI I had done. That's all I think about, guys, is fishing. I mean, if my friends and longtime clients will tell you, you can call me at night. We will talk fishing for hours. I love fishing. It's what I do. I'm lucky I get to make a living a mile from my house on this beautiful river, the St. Joe. And that, for steelhead anyway, I should say. I guide a lot of other rivers as well. But for steelhead, it's primarily the St. Joe and one of the tributaries of the St. Joe. Hopefully that's that MRI joke you guys are laughing at. Not me cutting myself when I shave today. So here's the joke. Starts out in South Central Michigan. Comes into Indiana right there, South Bend. The reason it's called South Bend, it's the southernmost bend of the river. Before it jumps, it goes directly north from South Bend over the state line and dumps into Lake Michigan, which is where we get our steelhead from. It's the fish that they love. It's the elusive fish that everybody wants to catch. Oftentimes I hear people say, that they're just dying to catch. They've gone all over the country and they've tried to catch steelhead and they haven't done it. It's a phenomenal fishery. I had somebody a couple years ago, never caught a steelhead, and by lunch she had landed 4 fish on the St. Joe. And it is that kind of fishery. We'll put some fish in the net most days. It's fishing, you never know, but it's pretty darn productive. So types of rods we're using, 9-foot 8 weights with a large arbor reel, floating line. That's kind of our nymphing or indicator fishing. We're using, that'd be awesome, Omar. Team bonding experience. Omar coaches college soccer at Holy. Awesome. What a fun time that'd be. Do we get the So 9-foot 8 weight with our nymphing stuff, we're using Lamson, and I've used it now, and that was the best move I've ever made. Lamson, they are phenomenal reels. In reel back for repair, and that's Jake and I pounding on. I mean, it's almost a year-round steelhead fishery, which just wonderful reel. For our switch and space stuff, You know, we're using both switch and spay rods, using Skagit lines. I don't mess around with Scandi lines. And I'll talk about this now before I forget. I still do a lot of switch and spay rods. And I'll show you that technique. Anymore on the St. Joe, I don't really take a 9-foot switch rod or in a spay rod in the boat. Three different techniques, for the most part, that we're using for steelhead. We've got a high stick nymph. So if we're high sticking, and I'll show you kind of that technique here in a second, this is what we're using. I don't know why I have running line in there because we never use it. I took it out last night and left it for some reason. So we've got fly line going down to a 9 to 12 feet. Typically it's 9. Very rarely is it 12 unless it's winter time. 6 to 8 pound leader, maybe you go up to 10 on that. Then we've got, like we said last night, a blood knot to hold the split shot up, and then the two flies. Unless we're in Indiana. Remember, Indiana on the St. Joe, you can only use one. So if we're in Indiana, we can only use one fly. And here's kind of the bottom a couple times as it drifts. You don't want to pound the bottom. We just want to feel it a couple times. Oh, then the line, watch the line tighten up right now, fish on. So that's high stick nymphing. It's not the prettiest thing in the world, but it is a super productive method, especially in the spring for catching steelhead. Winter as well. All right, second nymphing rig we have is a strike indicator nymph rig. So now we're with slack on the water. Regular leader, 9 foot, 12 foot leader. That changed. Here. Everything else is really the same. It's just now we've got an indicator, and now we're fishing with, instead of a tight line, we throw a big ugly line. So Skagit head is running line we're going to work out, and the indicator literally is going to end up down here before we start to recast. We're just letting that running line move on out. The indicator literally is right there. You can cover so much water doing that technique. So all it is a Skagit head, a normal leader like we would normally use for indicator, and we just strip the running line right up to the rod tip. So the head is just outside the rod tip. Cast 45 degrees, we throw a mend in, and then we can just let that running line fly. It's like center pinning with you really cover a ton of. Here is our more traditional non-nymphing spay rig. And I'm not going to go too heavily into spay fishing tonight because I've got a whole program. We could talk hours on spay fishing. We do a couple of classes in the summer, a couple of spay classes that I would love to have some of you over if you're really interested in improving your spay casting and improving your knowledge about spay fishing. Love to have you over for those. But we'll touch a little bit on spay fishing tonight. But it's just a whole lot to go through. So we've got running line down to a Skagit head. And then we've got a 5 to 15 foot sink tip. And that sink tip is going to depend on the length of it, and the density of it is going to depend on what kind of water we're fishing. Then we've got a straight piece of mono, 3 feet, 16 pound. For me, I'm normally throwing 12. I think Jake normally throws 16. He doesn't like to play around with those fish. He likes to land them. That's kind of, we talked the other night about streamer pike and how we use just a straight piece of mono, and it's the same principle here. I don't want a butt section holding that fly up, and I'm not a fan at all of fluorocarbon, especially when it comes to spay casting and swinging streamers for steelhead. So I don't want a big butt section of mono. I want that mono to get sucked right into the water with that sink tip and that heavy fly, and I want it down in that strike zone. So I don't use a traditional tapered leader. I throw a straight piece of mono and I'm done with it. There is enough power in that cast to get it done. I was waiting for you, Jake. All right. So look, spay casting is not hard. And I think a lot of folks are intimidated by it. This is literally, she picked this up very well. It's not a great, but it doesn't have to. That's the beauty of it. And fish on. This is literally 20 minutes into her first spay cast. It's not a difficult thing to do. I think that most people on here would pick that up, two-handed casting up, quicker than you ever did single-handed casting. And I would love to have you over for our spay school so I could prove that to you. All right, why spay casting? Well, number one, it's a great way to cover water. And watch this cast, okay? So we're going to fish from that bank, and that fly is going to catch this current seam, and it's going to end up all the way over there. Look at how much water we're able to cover on that cast. Think about how long it would take you to nymph fish that run. You would be there for days. I mean, it would take you forever. Watch the rod tip here. If you can see it well, it's going to get really lightly pulled. Some of these fish rip the rod out of your hand. Some of them just lightly pull it. But the fly right now is right out here. You'll see this fish eat coming up right there. And you can see where the fish was. He ate it right over here. Look how much water we covered. That's one advantage to spay casting, is we get to cover a lot of water. The other advantage to spay casting is this. When a fish eats a high stick nymph rig, it's bouncing along and it stops. Sometimes it's bottom, sometimes it's a fish. When a fish eats an indicator rig, you don't feel anything until you set the hook. When a fish eats a slung streamer, it's like sticking your finger in the electric socket in your wall. I mean, it is as intense of an experience as you can have in fly fishing. December through January or February, what you're going to notice is stop. We pretty much have a year-round fishery. Months, but other than that, we have steelhead around it. So water temps at this point in the wintertime are under 40 degrees. That's kind of what we're talking about. The biggest key to catching fish in the winter is to remind yourself you're not insulated like those critters right there. If you're not dressed to spend the day out in that weather, you're not going to. How many fish we have in the river, if you're freezing to death, you're not going to fish well. It's just that simple. You're worried about staying alive. But a couple of foot waders. Okay, whether it's neoprene or Gore-Tex, boot foot waders is a must for fishing during the winter if you want to feel your feet. If you want your feet to feel like rocks, then wear regular stocking foot waders. But if you want to have your feet actually feel the rocks that you're walking on, boot foot waders is the way to go. Another thing, you're going to get ice on your guides during the winter. One of the Facebook forums in Michigan today was talking about what to use. And people said, you know, chapstick and Vaseline and Stanley's Ice Off, all this different stuff. Here is what we use. And the reason we use this stuff is a couple. There are two main reasons. Number one, doesn't harm our fly lines. Number two, doesn't stick on our fly lines and gum them all up like chapstick or Vaseline, Stanley's Ice Off. The other nice thing, all of those products other than chapstick, because it's in an applicator, you have to get your fingers in them to get them on the guides. It's a pain in the butt. Here's what we use. It's a simple fix. None of those products, including this one, are going to eliminate ice on your guides. But this one does as good a job as all those products. And you don't have to get it on your fingers. And it doesn't stick on your fly lines. You don't have to clean your fly lines every night after you use it. This is what we use to keep the ice off. And it works. All right, type of water we're fishing during the winter. We've got right here that's going to hold fish. This is shallow stuff. This is dead water. This is 8 feet. We're going to fish that. In the winter, make sure you cover that sucker really well. You know, in the fall, probably just run right through the middle here, right through here. But in the winter, they'll move way out onto those seams. So make sure you cover that water really well in the winter. Flies we're using. Egg flies in the winter, washed out pinks and whites and yellows. Also, we get a great stonefly hatch around here. So late February, or really even in January, if we ever see the sun, which is we see the sun in January, there are a lot of stoneflies around then too. So we throw a lot of prince nymphs and a lot of is not as productive as any other time of the year. But if you're going to see winter, drop down in size, go more realistic in color. That's the key to winter steelheading with streamer. You can watch the Weather Channel. Find one of those days like this or like this where it's sunny. We've got the barometric pressures kind of steady or rising. The wind's down. The afternoon is typically best because the water's warmed up some.
And those are the kind of days you want to find during the winter. Now, saying that, if you remember the very first picture I showed you, you could hardly see us because it was so. Yeah, Court, Pam's clients buy Pam cooking spray. Garlic, I think, might work better. I don't know. But if you remember back that very first slide I showed you, like a blizzard and we're holding a fish. You can catch fish no matter what the weather is, but these types of days right here typically are the most productive. All right, spring steelhead, March and April. Now we're talking water temps above 42 typically. We're talking water temps where we get some migration. So this is the time of the year, March and April, where you're going to catch the most fish. It's the time of the year where you're going to catch the largest fish, like this 35-incher from last month or this 34. I think that was right on 34. From last month as well. Two giant steelhead. The reason we catch such big, so it's just an average, law of averages game. That's when we catch the most is in the spring. One, we can see the fish. Only a steelhead. Fishing for spawning fish, I really don't have a moral issue with. A lot of other rivers we do, but yeah, that was Kerry. So in the spring, I can tell you, hey, Joe, that cast was a foot and a half too far, or it was too short. Yes, that's the cast right on his head. So we've shown him 10 casts. He's not eating it. All right, well, let's change flies. Whereas in the winter, in the fall, we can say, I'm pretty sure there's a fish in that hole, but I'm not real sure where he's at. The other reason why spring is so productive is any fish that has come in since the summer. So that's another reason. It's, again, law of averages. We have more fish any other time of the year. Flies we're using, hex sparrow, phenomenal fly for this time of the year. Eggs work all year. They just do. What I like in the spring for the most part are two different colors, Oregon cheese and chartreuse. I really like pink and purple. Water typically is a little off color in the spring, although this spring it's really clear. But normally it's a little off color, so we're throwing pinks and purples and blacks quite a bit. If you've got a kid or a beginner that you want to teach how to catch a steelhead, spring's time to do it. Again, kids want to, but especially kids, they want to catch fish. They want to feel poles. All right, where else can you hug a fish? Take your kids. All right, summer runs, June to September. We typically see the summer, June, early July. This is a run kind of like the out last night that is not a real guarantee. Summer run, some years it kind of slow. Again, though, like to come over and try to hit summer runs in July and they're not there. Pike are there. Smallmouth fishing's top notch in July, so there are other options. But if they are there, and make sure you hear this part, if the water temp is well below 70 degrees, go fish for summer runs. If the water temp is above 70, leave them alone. All you're going to do is kill them. They're trying to survive when the water temp is that warm. But if the water temp is below 70, they are one heck of an awesome fish. There's nothing like going out and wet wading for steelhead. This is a summer run. And this is a summer run in March, late March, maybe early April. Okay, so what we've got here, a lot of people think that it's just a summer thing. It's not a summer thing. It is a run. So when those fish come in the summer, they're staying until the spring, late winter, when they spawn. So if you hear we have a good summer run, they're there all fall, they're there in the winter, and they're there in the very early spring. Flies we're using typically in the summer, I'm swinging streamers. I like those aggressive takes and those summer runs. So I'm swinging a lot of streamers like this iced out. If I'm nymphing, I'm throwing a lot of small nymphs, like a mysis shrimp. Again, summer runs are all the videos you're going to see here, even though a lot of them are in the fall, most of them are summer runs. You'll see how they fight here in a little while. If the water temps are low enough, they are the best fighting steelhead you'll ever hook. They're the only fish I've ever seen jump over. Seen spin so fast when it was hooked that it literally knocked itself out. And Jake had one jump, hit a client in the chest. That's a summer run steelhead. They are an fish. All right, fall steelhead. So if I had 1 month to fish steelhead, I would pick November. To me, November is the pinnacle of the reason for that. Number one, they're bright like this one. And those types of fish love to eat and fly. I love to spay cast. I love to teach spay cast. People learn to spay cast. And then I love to see that first pull. Because, again, it's like sticking your finger in an electric socket. If you haven't done it yet, it is an amazing, absolutely amazing, hair-raising. Please remember, foam is the home, right? But it's just a migratory rainbow trout. Foam is the home. Make sure you cover that foam really well. I'll tell you a quick story, since everybody likes it. When I was guiding in Montana, I went over and fished Dillon, Montana, and I drove by. I don't know why I was on this road. Town road. I don't know why I was on it. Went through a little neighborhood, and I see on the side of a, as it says, home of the caddis fly, or home of the elk here. Caddis. So I like, shoot, it's a fly shop. So of course I swing in. Nobody's around, and I see this guy comes outside. And can I help you? I said, I wanted to see if the shop was open. He says, oh, I'm come on in. I'm tying flies. Well, long story short, it turned out who invented the elk hair caddis, which was the reason it said. And Al sat with me. I'll bet we. There was a book that had come out about the same time called Wisdom. Troutfish, get that book, Wisdom of the Guy, written by a gentleman from Evansville, Indiana, Paul Arnold. And that book is a phenomenal insight in fly fishing, trout, fly fishing guides. We probably sat for 2.5 hours and just talked. One of the stories he told me is when he moved from Pennsylvania out to Montana, and he'd always heard, hey, foam is the home, and he's looking at the fridge, he dumped the box of Cheerios, and he drove. Said when those Cheerios got to that next bridge, they were in a on the foam line. Look, Cheerios that are floating down it, or nymphs, or in crayfish, or salmon eggs, they are called the home, and it is because it's a conveyor belt. A lot of caddis flies. Again, there are certain flies we use all year long. Caddis, hex nymphs, stone flies, whether that be a prince nymph or a wire stone, and eggs. Those are, when we're nymphing, those are always, no matter what time of the year, they're always productive. The caddis is a real productive one. This is the halo egg that I tied the other night. Estaz egg that I tied the other night. There are thousands and thousands and thousands of salmon eggs dumping into the river in the fall, and there are steelhead behind every bed eating them. So eggs work really well. Hex them, streamer rods out, and start swinging. To me, there is no better way to catch these beautiful, majestic steelhead than on a big swung streamer. And yes, Jake, that is a George Michael leech in its mouth. I'll say it nicely. You're not. Swinging. What we have up here is we have salmon spawning around this corner. We have obviously very shallow water right here, so there aren't going to be any steelhead here. So through process of elimination, we can eliminate two-thirds of the river. We have salmon spawning here, so I can guarantee you there are going to be steelhead back behind those beds in that deep water. That's the water we're fishing. 6 to 8 feet of water right through there. And again, whether we're swinging or whether we're nymphing, that's what we're looking for. All right, this video I put together a couple of years ago because I just couldn't come up with a way to tell people how unbelievably awesome it is to have a steelhead eat your streamer. They literally try to rip the rod out of your hand. Years ago, get the rod ripped out of his hand, pulled the rod. The fish went under a log. Jake went down, grabbed the line, pulled the rod underneath the log as well. Handed the rod back to the guy, and he landed the fish. When they eat really strongly. So this is a video I put together. Hopefully you can hear it, because that's really what it's about, is being able to hear this thing. Hopefully you can hear it. It's going to have some great jumps. Almost all of these are summer runs. So I put this together to kind of, again, show you just how energetic and how exciting Zen state. Just walking one step at a time, making a good cast, and it swing. Making a cast, taking a step, letting it swing. That's kind of what we do. And then all of a sudden, you don't just let it swing. Something tries to rip the rod out of your hand, and sometimes it does. Little George Michael leech, Jake. Remember that video right there, so later on. That was an awesome one. I'm very excited about that. That's a summer run. Almost knocking the bowl. Another summer run. They don't always end in a fish in the boat, but they always end in a smile. But that, to me, is what swinging is about. It is, again, kind of like we talked about in musky fishing. It's hunting. It's a whole lot of, well, some days a whole lot of nothing. Other days a whole lot of something. But you're going a lot, and you take a step, and you cast, and you take a step, and you start just kind of turning your mind off until something really wakes you up. And to me, that is the pinnacle of steelhead fishing. All right, a couple of quick things on swinging, and I'm not swinging because, again, I could talk for, well, during our space hour seminar on swinging. So I won't get too much into it, but I want to go to the next slide. But in order to very strongly, right, you're going to hear me talk about making sure to let it swing. He starts to pick it up, and I said, no, let it swing. Watch that line. Wham. He unfortunately sets the hook, and when you let a steelhead eat and not set the hook, you land them. But when you set the hook on a fish that's swimming away from you, and you've got an 11, it's just too much energy. If you've got too much leverage in your hand, and the fish has to break them off. So what we do is, with your Spaco reels, they are a click paw drag system. And when the fish eats, there is no of our spay reels and switch. All of our reels are Spaco out of Wisconsin. And the click paw, number one, slow startup. Number two of the dragon, that hard jerk. Number three, fish run on a click paw reel. There is no better sound. Is a phenomenal song that we have switched all of our spay reels over to Spaco, because we love that click paw drag system. We just seem to land. We don't seem to. We do. We land more fish on that. All right, flies we're using in the fall. Pretty big, pretty bulky, and bright. We're not afraid of size in the fall. They will eat big flies. Even the kind of muted colors have a lot of flash in them. All right. Couple of quick stories, because everybody loves a good fishing story. So I told you to remember that video of that fish right up against the log jam. This is Andrew, and Andrew got that fish to eat right off that log jam. Unfortunately, that fish ended up going into that log jam in about 2 seconds. And log jam, not only was the tippet in the log jam, not only was it 10 feet of sink tip into the log jam, but probably 10 feet of the skagit head was wrapped in the logs as well. So chances of us landing it were slim to none. So I rode over, mainly to undo my fly line and sink to laying there tied so tight to the log that it couldn't move. So I dip the tender, don't move a muscle. I'm going to dip the net in underneath this fish, and I'm going to lift it as fast as I can in hopes that it breaks the tippet, and we land the fish. And we did. And Andrew, an awesome fish. I don't know if you can see it, but it was literally wrapped. You can see the fly line wrapped four times around the fish. That's how wrapped up that thing got in the log jams. It was just unbelievable. All right, Doug. Everybody's asked me the other night about my favorite fish, and I told you the story about Danny Gilmartin, and this is one of the biggest steelhead I've ever put. That was an absolutely awesome fish. I mean, that fish, especially for a young guy to get that fish. Comments here. Let me check. Make sure there weren't any questions. Yeah, Jake. There's some way I'm coming up. Maybe you're going to have to. Oh, that's exactly right. That last one. That's what goes. And what for a 12-year-old to catch that fish the other night, not only did he get that one, which was one, not, I don't know, 2-3 hours later, he hooked one of that river in a spot I wouldn't expect myself to cast, right on the money. I mean, it was, he is a fisherman, even at 12 years old, man. That kid, great kid, and so many great memories with him as it was, man, what a fish that was. I'll never. All right, this fish taught me a lesson, and here's the lesson it taught me. I don't think. Okay. Often you hear that if you're a streamer and if you're a nymphing, close to being true most of the year. There are times of year where nymphing is definitely more productive, winter being one of those. But this fish right here, really well, and Adam's a very good really well. And his buddy Dan comes down behind. He's like, hey, swing this. And I'm like, buddy, Adam hit that hole so well, he would have gotten it. Let's roll. Hearted cast, like, you know, ah, crap. Threw it in and that fish ate. I used to think that fish that ate streamers was because we just flat out covered more water. Like I showed you that video a little while ago, how long that would take to nymph that run compared to swing that run. But there are some fish, and this fish proved it to me, that you want to eat because this fish, we talked about when you're swinging streamers, make sure to let that fly hang down. Don't pick it out too early. You made the hard cast. You've made the good swing. Let this fish, though, Roger, who's holding the fish here, while it was dangling and swinging. So he picked up the phone. He talked. I had it on video. He talked for 4 minutes. He put the phone. I don't know, Randall. I'm sorry. I looked just now. YouTube seems to be running fine. I don't know. But so Roger talked on the phone for 4 minutes and 58 seconds. He put the phone back in his pocket. He stripped the recast and the fish ate. Literally, that fish was sitting for almost 5 minutes. Now, I always tell people, let the fly dangle at the end of the drift. You don't need to let it dangle for 5 minutes. But it worked on that fish. This photo, this brings back memories. This is one of the second, maybe the second year I guided. Might even have been the first spring I guided. And Ray Miles on the left was the. I met Ray down at Fly Masters in Indianapolis. He guides up on the St. Joe, and the guy's like, no, there aren't. So I walked over, and it was before I started. I mean, I know the river well, and I'll take you. And he said, I gave him my phone number and about 6 for the day. And I remember coming home that this is what I want to do with my life. I want to take people 1 years ago. So on this day, I called Ray. The fishing is, the steelhead fishing is as good as it will, you will ever. And if I bring my good buddy Frank along to videotape, back before we had, you know, cameras on our chests and hats like we do. And he said, oh yeah, bring Frank, that's great. So we brought Frank, probably maybe a Super 8 back then, I don't know. We hooked so many steelhead. And Frank, if Dustin's got enough video and grab a rod, I can't catch all these fish. And we steelhead that day. It was an amazing, amazing steelhead. I'll never forget that day as long as I live. And if it wasn't for that guy about fishing right now, I owe him a debt. Ray, unfortunately, his health doesn't lie. And man, what a great guy. All right, this fish, this was a massive fish. Every giant fish I catch, it seems like the person that lands it is, Marty's a big dude. That is, if not the largest, it's the second largest. And that fish, we saw it sitting, the giant shadow, sitting in a trough. And I said, Marty, there is a giant sitting in there. And he sets the hook, and I'm like, oh my God, yeah, that's him. He goes downriver, and then he goes across the river. And then he goes upriver, and he's literally right along the far bank, just kind of swimming upriver. Not slowly swimming, but swimming straight upriver, right along the far bank. So Marty's like, what do you want to do? And I said, well, we need to cross, but I'd be honest, man, the river's high. We might both end up getting wet. He's like, I don't care. Let's do it. So we crossed the river. Luckily, we stayed, you know, dry, thank God. The fish was so far into the backing, and it was right against the bank. I'm like, Marty, this is probably – we're probably at this point hooked on to a log because the fish is so far upriver and there's so many logs sticking off the bank. So we're walking up the river, you know, it's maybe 3 feet of water. And again, we're still in the backing at this point. Marty's reeling like crazy, but, you know, line's just coming in. There's nothing going out. There's no real hard tension anymore. And I figured that we had lost him. And I'm just in front of Marty, kind of going along, watching for logs, make sure he doesn't fall. And I looked down at my feet, and there's the fish laying there. It was wrapped around the log, probably, I don't know, 30 yards upriver. And it had come back down, and it just expended all its energy. It was literally just hanging in the current. So I reached down. It was kind of like Andrew's fish. I reached down. I told Marty, don't move a muscle. It's sitting right here, literally. And it was just kind of sitting there. I put the net under it. I lifted as fast and hard as I could. Luckily, the tippet broke, the fish went in the net, and the rest was history. And that was one of the largest steelhead, one or two. That was one or two. I don't know if his was larger or if Danny Gilmartin's was larger, but they were both giant steelhead. Even I get lucky on occasion. Not very often because I don't get the fish very much. I'm on the river guiding too much. But I do get out on occasion. 50? Oh, man. It wasn't 50. That was 35. And we landed a 35 this spring. We've landed plenty of 35s, but fat 35. That's absolutely massive. All right. Let me jump back over here.
All right.
What questions do we have? So we talked a lot of steelhead tonight. To me, like I said the other night, pike are my favorite. I absolutely love pike. But I'm an anomaly. Most of our clients prefer steelhead over anything else.
I spend and Jake spends way more days. I spend way more days guiding steelhead than I do any other species of fish. It's not even close. Most of our clients love steelhead. And we get folks from all over the country coming to fish the St. Joe for steelhead. I mean, this spring we've had people from, and I'm sure I'm going to miss out on a couple, but we've had Jake, let me know if we're wrong here. I'll answer those questions in a second. We've had people from California, obviously Indiana, Ohio, Michigan, Illinois, Kentucky, Arizona. We have fished with someone from every state for steelhead except for Hawaii. Jake and I talked about that the other night. Neither of us had anybody from Hawaii. But we have literally fished with someone from every state for steelhead. You know, it is a super popular fish. And part of that reason is that they're not easy to catch. It's challenging. The St. Joe kind of levels the playing field, though. It is a phenomenal steelhead fishery. All right, couple questions. What is the method to land, or what kind of net do you prefer? Jake and I both use rubber-coated nets. We used to use a lot of mesh, but now that the rubber-coated nets are a little more readily available and they're making them larger, I prefer those. It's a little easier on the fish. They're a little heavier, but they're actually easier to get through the water than the mesh nets were. Mesh really grabbed a lot of water. So rubber-coated nets is what we're using. Frable. Those two steelhead close to the state record? Not really. They really weren't that close. Is there a preferred cast for presentation to steelhead? Well, it's going to depend on what technique we're using. And if we're on the big river, one of the smaller ones. So there's some variables there. If we're indicator fishing on the smaller river, or if we're indicator fishing with a switch rod, yeah, kind of a roll cast. Kind of a modified roll cast works well. If we're high sticking on the small river, then we're still with that roll cast. If we're high sticking on the big river, though, it's not a roll cast any longer. At that point, we're making a water load cast. So we're bringing the rod in, throwing the fly behind us, letting it hit the water, and then coming over the top. So it's a water load. But we also do a ton of spay casting. So there are, you know, I guess, what's that, three different casts mainly that we use. We do not use an overhead false cast with steelhead. If you want to tie your flies in a knot, use that cast. If you want to try to stay tangle-free, don't make a false cast. There's just too much junk on the line going on. How come you rarely throw flies with egg heads? You mean like egg-sucking leeches, Andy? I think he means maybe like egg-sucking leeches. Oh, we throw egg-sucking leeches. It's not one of my favorite flies anymore, and we kind of talked about that the other night when we talked about flies. Some flies just, I don't know, fall out of favor. We find other things that so egg-sucking leeches. We find other things that work better, or maybe we just get tired of using the same thing year after year after year. You know, if you'd have asked me that 20 years ago, probably every rig I ever tied had an egg sucking leech on it. But it's just not something we use a lot of now. We still carry them in four different colors, but it's just not something I use a whole lot of anymore. Gene asks, am I still booking trips? Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. We're still booking trips. You know, we're kind of shut down for the most part until, you know, things are open back up, but yeah. Smallies, we better be fishing by the time smallmouth are around. Do you use sculpin patterns much? Yeah, absolutely. I think the majority of our steelhead swinging flies are sculpin imitations. I think that's the majority. If they're realistic, I should say, if they're realistic streamers, they look a lot like sculpins. But I think a lot of those fish, they're not eating it because it looks like something. They're eating it because of that aggressive, I'm mad, I want that thing out of my face, I don't want it in my area type of eat. I don't think for the most part it's a, yeah, that looks like a sculpin, or yeah, that looks like a shad, or they don't eat shad, but alewife. I don't think they really do that. I think it's more, I'm pissed off. I want that out of my lair. This is my home. This isn't anybody else's home. Do you think you need to be the first guy down the river? Adam, of course. Stay out of my way. No. You know, I especially if you're not fishing the same techniques as everybody else. No, not at all. And one of the things on the Joe, if we're fishing the lower river, closer to Lake Michigan, we'll get some charter boats that'll go through with, you know, six rods hanging out with lures. And I mean, they basically sweep the river. I mean, they cover every inch of it. And you would think, man, I don't want to go behind those guys. But the reality is they're throwing such a different presentation than what we're throwing. I'll go right behind those guys and catch fish right after they went through. On the other hand, they'll come right behind us and catch fish because it's such a different presentation. So, no, I don't really worry about that. I'll tell you another thing that kind of makes a lot of difference, too. You know, we used to have a guy that would come down the river that wasn't really adept at rowing, and he'd bang into every log jam. And we would fish a run really hard, and we'd just get ready to leave, and we'd hear him coming, and he'd literally do circles down the river, and he'd bang the logs. And all of a sudden, we started to notice after he hit the logs in front of us that we would catch fish. And sometimes it was nice that he went down before us because the fish were tucked in underneath the logs. He would hit the log and the fish would come out into the run. So sometimes it's advantageous to have people go down in front of you. So, yeah, of course, smallmouth, we're going to be talking about that next week at some point. We'll be doing this, I think, four nights next week. We've got trout. We've got smallmouth. We've got long-nosed gar. Oh, and then we've got one. The last one we're going to end on is kind of our favorite gear. And we're going to talk about different vices and different, you know, tying stuff. And we're going to talk about tools. And we're going to talk about rods and reels and tippet and all that fun stuff. So, yeah, we'll be talking about smallmouth next week. So it's for a kid or for beginner, either one. It's, for an expert. I don't care who you are. Smallmouth on this river, there's nothing like it. A bad day is 30 smallmouth. It is a phenomenal river. Andy, do you think the big flood recently blew out some spots so they no longer hold fish? Are you talking about the flood in 2018? I'm going to assume that's what we're talking about, so we'll talk about that. So we had a major, major flood in 2018. The St. Joe had the largest – it was the largest flood we'd ever had on the Joe since they've been measuring water. I think we were up to almost 30,000 cubic feet per second. If I remember correctly, the water, you know, over the years, people would say, how high does the water get? And I'd say, maybe there. I was off by about 5 feet. Again, it was 5 feet higher than I ever thought it could get. It was 10 feet above where it's at now. I've got a few spots marked on the river, and it's amazing to stand in the boat and look up at the angle and see where the water used to be in February of 2018. It was unbelievable. As far as changing the river, though, Andy, I'll be honest, man, it did not change the river a whole lot. It definitely blew out some log jams. It didn't really move a lot of gravel around. It didn't really fill in very many holes or dig other holes. I was shocked. I thought it would. I thought we'd have a new river to learn, to be honest with you. Didn't change it much at all. It really didn't change it much at all, which shocked me. Probably shocks you that I'm answering it that way. But it really didn't change that river much at all. You know, I was shocked by that because it was high. Man, was it unbelievable. I never thought I'd see anything like it. Tell you what it did do is it cleaned it out so much that the river, both the Dee and the St. Joe, stay a lot clearer after rains now than they did before that major, major flood. Well, yeah, it's that definitely was an advantage. Any other questions? Can't see. Let me get over here on. Hey, Eric, I didn't see you on there. How are you, buddy? Oh, thank you, Terry. It's called a hex sparrow. I don't know if you were on earlier. And so I haven't been pulling names, and I forgot all about that. But one of the things we're going to do is give some flies away. I've got all sorts of stuff back in the back room. And when I think about it tomorrow, I'll start pulling names for the first three and start sending some stuff off. Tube flies, Denton. I don't use any tube flies. We don't use any tube flies at all.
Everything that we do is on a shank with a trailing hook of wire, or if it's a leech pattern, a trailing hook of backing, really, is what it is. So no, we don't use any tube flies at all. Andy, any fall openings? Not very many, but we do have some. November and October are getting very, very tight. So, if you're looking to get into the fall, get with me ASAP. We'll get some dates in there because we don't have very many. We're getting very booked up. Yeah, Denton, back to the tube fly thing. I just never really got into tying tube flies. I'll be honest. I didn't really see the big advantage. We used to tie on the cheapest hooks we could find and just cut the hooks off. I don't have any of my swinging flies here to show you why we do that. I don't have any of my swinging flies down here. So what he's asking is on a big steelhead streamer, you know, they're long. I mean, they're at the minimum of that's a really small one. This is a whip finish here that's probably 3 inches long. They're more like this whip finisher. I mean, they're big streamers. And if we're using a fixed hook on a streamer that large, when the steelhead shakes its head, we get a lot of torque. And we don't want that torque. But what we do want is we want that hook all the way back in the tail as far as we can get, because we're swinging that streamer to them tail first. And so they're going to a lot of times just nip at the tail. So we do put a trailing hook way back at the tail. We cut the other hook off. Well, now we just tie on shanks that didn't have hooks to begin with. But when we first started tying those flies, there weren't shanks that were available. So we had to use just the cheapest long hooks we could find and then cut the hook off. But no, we never really got into tube flies. Didn't really see a whole big advantage as far as the way we were tying them with those cheap hooks. But I know a lot of guys love tube flies. It just seemed to me that it was a lot of extra work and not a whole lot of advantage. But I know a lot of guys, you know, it's like anything with tying. I mean, there are guys that tie ultra realistic patterns that look like, you know, I've got a buddy, Junior, down in Indianapolis, and Junior ties these cockroach flies that if I brought one home and put it on my floor, my wife would run screaming because she would think it was the real McCoy. I mean, they are as realistic as they come. Do they fish any better? I don't know. I don't know that fish eat cockroaches, but some of Junior's patterns that are more fish worthy, they look super realistic. For us, they're awesome to look at. I don't know if they fish any better. I don't really get into the real ultra-realistic stuff, but that's the fun of fly tying. It's the fun of fishing. You know, I've got one buddy that if he's not catching a steelhead on a two-handed rod and swinging a streamer, he's catching it on a single-handed rod and stripping a streamer. He does not nymph at all. All he does is swing streamers or strip streamers. He doesn't catch as many fish as a lot of people, especially now that he just pretty much strips streamers. He doesn't care. He's caught his steelhead in his life, and he wants to do it the way he wants to do it now. Great question, Andy. Do we ever use intermediate spay lines? Absolutely. On the St. Joe, that's primarily what I use if I'm swinging streamers. Now, if I'm nymphing, I use a floating skagit. But on the Big River, if I'm using a skagit to swing a streamer, it's almost always an intermediate. Yeah, great question. So Scientific Angler, Third Coast skagit is what we use. On the smaller river, we're using typically a floater with a sink tip, but we like the floater in there. This allows us to control the line a little better on mending and control the drift a little better. But on the Big River, where you saw some of those videos where the fish could be on the bank, it could be 30 yards off the bank, anywhere in there can hold a fish. I want to get that fly down, and I want it to be at a nice level drift. So, yeah, on the Big River, that's pretty much all I use is intermediates. Have you ever seen anyone catch a steelhead on a mop fly? No, I don't know that we've ever had anybody use a mop fly. I know we never had anybody use a mop fly. I bet they'd catch steelhead, though. I don't know why they wouldn't. I mean, a small one is basically, especially if it's in a, olive or a green, a small one's basically a caddis. So I don't know why they wouldn't work. Gene asked Dustin, on any given day, have you ever noticed fly line color making a difference? No, I don't notice, Gene. It's a great question, but I don't notice fly line making any difference at all. For the most part, we're not putting the fly line over the fish. It's the tippet and the leader. But no, I've never really noticed that make a difference at all for any species for that matter. Now, what I will say, though, is it can make a big difference on the negative side if you can't see the line. So when we're smallmouth fishing, for instance, and it's late in the evening, if we can't see that line, we can't pick up the take as well. So there are times where different color, brighter lines actually are a huge advantage. You know, I like to be able to see my fly line because your fly line tells you what your leader is doing. Your leader tells you what your fly is doing. So if I can't figure out what the end of my fly line is doing as far as drag or drift or movement for smallmouth fishing, then a lot of times I don't know what my fly is doing. So I like bright lines. I like to be able to see my fly line. When we're spay casting, I hate dark lines. Can't stand them. Again, I want to know, do we have a belly in the line? Because the belly in the line does two things. It decreases or increases, depending on how big or small the belly is, the depth that the fly is swinging at, and it increases or decreases the speed that the fly is swinging at. It also changes the angle at which the fly swings, whether it's broadside or it's tail first. And those are the three things: depth of the fly, speed of the swing, and whether or not we're broadside or tail first. Those are the three things that make a difference in whether a fish is going to eat or not. In my opinion, it's not the fly. If we're swinging streamers, I'd be honest with you, I have my favorites. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I have my favorites. And I carry, I don't know, we probably carry 35 different streamers in various colors for steelhead. I have my favorites. We have 35 in the box. I don't think it matters. I think that the fish, if it's going to eat olive, would have eaten pink, would have eaten white. It's the speed of the swing, the depth of the swing, and the profile that we're giving that fish to look at that makes the biggest difference. If the fish is a player, he's a player. I don't think he cares about the color of the fly. Let me back up. You ever target wood on the big river or just sweep the runs? That's not true. There are some smaller runs that have wood in them. So, yeah, we do that. But I would say more so than not, we're covering, if we're talking swinging streamers, we're covering water through the runs. There are times, though, depending on the run, where we'll set up on the inside and let it swing into the wood and strip it out of the wood a little bit. There are other times we're on the opposite side casting to the wood and letting it swing. And all that depends on depth that the wood's in and the amount of current that the wood's in. So, yeah, we will target some wood on the big river. Yep. Have you ever had a steelhead try to eat the strike indicator? Absolutely. That's a fall and late summer thing that happens often. Doesn't happen as often as it used to because we don't throw nymphs as much as we used to. We're mainly swinging at that time of the year. But yeah, absolutely, we've had that happen. Jake probably remembers this fish. I remember a fish, Adam, in the upper hell hole that ate the indicator like 3 or 4 times. It just kept coming up and eating it. And that was back early on. And man, I wished I carried dry flies back then, but I didn't. I do now, but I didn't back then. That thing would have eaten the bomber, no question about it. Why is the water so low on the Joe? Craig asked. It's not that low, Craig. It's pretty normal right now. I'd have to look at the levels to confirm how normal it is. So on the St. Joe, since that flood we talked about in 2018, we've only had 2 days of normal water on the St. Joe until recently. It has been super, super, super high, to the point that literally we've had 2 days until really recently of normal water. And it hasn't just been a little high. It has been really, really, really high. A lot of it has been double what it should be. So I don't think it's low right now. I don't bothered to look at levels a whole lot this time of the year because if I'm fishing, I don't really pay attention. But I would say it's probably pretty average right now. Check our website. We've got the USGS up there, but I don't, it's not real low. That's for sure. It might be a little low, but I bet you it's still above average for this time of the year. I really would. What's changed, though, is you're probably used to seeing it what it has been the last 2 years, which it is definitely lower than that right now because it has been really high the last 2 years. When nymphing with a skagit rod, do you use a floating tip or attach the leader directly to the head? Jeff, that's a great question. And I've done both. And I don't like to use a floating head. And here's why. It just gives too much extra length, even though it's only 7 to 9 feet of floating head. I'm sorry, a floating tip. It gives us another 7 to 9 feet that we have to control on the cast. So it gives us another 7 to 9 feet of line out when I really, at the beginning of the cast, I don't want a lot of line out. I want that head of the skagit, so the skagit head to be just outside of the rod tip. And I want the rest to be pretty short because I don't want to have a giant long cast. I want to be able to control where I put my cast. And then when I mend, I want to be right into the running line. So, no, I don't use a floating tip. I have. When we first started playing with that technique a lot, we put a floating tip on. But I have changed it and only just attach it right to the only attach the leader right to the head now. I don't use a floating tip any longer. But, man, that's a great question. Andy, man, love to have you, buddy. I don't look at the feet, Joe. What's the CFS? I don't ever pay attention to the feet. I can grab my computer here real quick too. Oh. Let's see what we're at. We're talking about river levels on the Joe. River guide service. I don't go to my own website for information very often. This is fun. Resources, water levels, St. Joe. Yeah, it's not low. It's exactly just above normal. 5,190 CFS. Normal is maybe 5,100 CFS, something like that. So here's kind of, if you can see the graph, there you go. You can see it a little bit. It was pretty high last week. It's about normal now. So that's, but Craig, probably what you're noticing is you've been watching the river and kind of making mental notes for the last 2 years because it's hard for us to remember past 2 years. And the last 2 years, it has been high. It's been really high. So it's almost normal. But we haven't had a day of normal yet this spring, I don't believe. We've been close. So I still think we've only had 2 days of normal water in over 2 years now. But boy, we're getting close. It hasn't, so kind of talk about water levels. It hasn't affected our spring steelhead fishing at all. Spring steelhead fishing has been normal, been great, still catching a bunch of fish. What it's affected negatively is our fall steelhead fishing, the high water. Well, it's been two things. It's been high water and it's been a really early winter. Jake and I went out last year on November 11th, I think it was. The water was 33.5 degrees. It doesn't turn 33.5 degrees until after Christmas most years. A lot of years, it's until January until we get that really hard, you know, freeze. This year, it was 33.5. I believe it was November 11th. So two things have hurt us the past two falls. Very high water and winters that came really early. It's hurt our smallmouth fishing some. But the thing is on the Joe, even a bad day, and I say this all the time, and this is the God's honest truth, a bad day is 30 fish. And so we've had a few more days where we've caught 35 fish instead of 75. So it has hurt our smallmouth fishing, but compared to other rivers, it's still been phenomenal. But it has, the high water has hurt our fall steelhead, and it's hurt our smallmouth fishing some. But other than that, it's not really hurt us at all. But hey, Joe, thanks for checking in, man. You stay healthy too, buddy. Can't wait to get back over and see you guys at the club. But Joe's in one of the best clubs in the world, man. Northern Kentucky Fly Fishers. What a great club. I'm so lucky. I had a club today. I won't say the name because I don't want everybody, if they didn't do it, I don't know. Anyway, I had a club today calling. I mean, we're lucky. The fly fishermen, we've got a great group of people. And I can't believe how many people have reached out and called just to check in. One of the clubs called today and bought a gift certificate. They said, hey, we want to help you out. We'll auction it off sometime down the road. But I know, we know you guys aren't working much. And we want to help out. And, man, that's what this whole thing, I don't know what else we can learn from. But I think there are a few other things. But hopefully everybody's had those types of things happen in their lives over the past month and a half. And you can look at those. And when this is all over, you realize just how great people are. And obviously you can find the negatives. There's no question about that. But hopefully we get through this and we can all look at those positive things. And those are the things we remember. So Court says, interesting, my last two falls way down from past years. Yeah. Now the fall salmon fishing has been great. It hasn't affected, the high water hasn't affected the fall salmon. But the fall steelhead has been tough. It has. Last fall was the worst fall Jake and I have ever had for numbers of fish caught. It was the worst fall. And that's 21 years of guiding, folks. And last fall was the toughest. And it was tough for two reasons. One, the fish were there. The fish were there. The ladder was full of fish. But there were two reasons. One was high water. So it just, what that does, here's what high water does. And here's why high water makes fishing tough. When the water is low, you know where they're sitting. When the water is high, they could be where you normally would wade. They're normally sitting, they could be sitting where you normally are wading, which is a foot of water. Well, now instead of a foot of water, it's 3 feet of water. And now where there's no water flowing over a log, there's water flowing over the log and the fish is sitting behind it. And it's literally your rod tip, but you don't see it. So that's one thing that happens in high water. There's just more water to fish. They can hide from us. Second thing that happened in the last two falls, like I said, was it was just cold. It turned cold so fast. Yes, hashtag lockjaw. That's what they had, man. The last two falls. Actually, two falls ago wasn't bad. This fall was real tough. This fall was a really tough year, tough fall. When November fish is worse than January, you know there was an issue. And November fish worse this last November. November 2019 was tougher fishing than January 2020. January 2020 was way easier than November of 19. And November, that's my month, man. That's the month I love to chase steelhead. Any other questions? The long one tonight. I'm glad it was. You guys are having fun and you're asking questions. I love it. I stay out here all night and talk fishing. So next week, we'll go Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, 9 o'clock. I'll probably send an email out again just to remind everybody. But next week, we'll be talking trout. We'll be talking long-nosed gar. We'll be talking smallmouth. And then we're just going to have a gear night. And we're going to talk about all the gear that we use, why we use it, and what it is, and why we're using that over something else. Hey, thanks, Mark. Good seeing you, buddy. Thank you so much, guys. If there aren't any questions, I'm going to head up. Hey, thanks, Tyler. Thanks, Sebastian. Dude, I send you a hat all the time. Are you needing a hat again? I saw you said something about a hat today. I don't remember whose post that was on. Thanks, Adam. Thanks for all the ideas, buddy. John, thanks for checking in, man. Eric Welch, go over there on YouTube. Thanks, buddy. Matt, you're welcome, pal. I hope you're doing well. Later, JB. Can't wait till we get on the river again, man. This is weird for Jake and I. Hey, Jake, Court wants to know about the U of M recruits. Purdue must have stolen one. Thanks, Craig, Matt, Mike. Mike, are you home yet? Or are you still on the road?